Hey, everyone. We just want to make a quick disclaimer here. We're going to talk about different bands on our show. We're not interested in really hashing out whether they're punk, emo, pop punk, post-industrial bluegrass.
We don't claim to be the authority on anything that we talk about.
We just want to talk about the memories we had with the music we grew up with.
We respect everyone's right to like what they like, and we know that every band is somebody's favorite band.
That being said, we want you to approach each episode with an open mind. We're here to take a look back at the music we grew up with. Although we've grown old, we don't have to grow up.
Welcome to the Pod Punk Show. Hello and welcome to the Pod Punk Show. My name is Aaron Haag.
And I'm John Bryan.
Coming at you from Uptown Manhattan, Washington Heights.
In the house.
Named after a bridge.
The Heights, I feel so much more comfortable now living in the Heights because of Lin-Manuel. That guy's, he just made it freaking awesome.
The biggest thing was like after that, like, because when I first moved to the Washington Heights, like I was working temp jobs and people would be like, where do you live? I'm like, I live in Manhattan. They're like, oh, like how do you live in Manhattan? I'm like, I live uptown. And they're like, oh, like the 120s? I'm like, no, I live in like the 180s.
Right. I live way uptown. I live in the Heights, yo.
Or I'd be like, I live in Washington Heights. And they're like, I don't know. That's a thing.
I love it too because like it just made it so like people can gentrify it even easier now.
Oh, you saw the coffee shop. I've known it's there. The coffee shop on like 186 and Broadway.
Yeah, I was walking to Aaron's apartment the other day, and I was walking by a coffee shop, and it was like one of those ones where it's like high end, like really hoity toity coffee, but it's not like a name brand.
No, I told you like yeah. it's a coffee shop where there's a guy with a MacBook Pro with a stocking hat on year round.
Yeah, like it's almost like the employees, like there's one guy that's making coffee, and then there's eight other employees that are just paid to sit at the tables with MacBooks and look busy. So other people are like, oh, I can go in here. It's a place I can hang.
Look at that. They have Apple products.
I was telling Aaron about it. He's like, yeah, that's been there forever. And then he pointed out that it's like in like an open ground floor warehouse. And they just like put a wall across and it doesn't touch the ceiling. But if you actually look at it, you can see like it just, they just basically built it out from that. And then there's just dead space all behind
it. Yeah, it's just like a partition wall that goes like almost to the ceiling. But you can see like they just like didn't finish building.
That is so cool. That is so
It's a thing that's like, it's cool. You're like, that's douchey cool, but it's still, you're kind of like, that's kind of cool.
But no, like what it does though, is it really helps exfoliate the beans. So instead of the beans being like burnt when they come out, it just makes them just like really taste the way that they were found.
This is what I like to do with my coffee beans. The first thing I do in the morning is I sing to them because, you know, everything has a soul. And I like to start with a little Mariah Carey, you know, get them up. You want to get them up high and then you want to bring them back down. I do some a little bluesy, a little sad song, maybe some Kurt Cobain.
Have you ever had the beans that are eaten by the monkey and it shits it out?
No, it's a cat, by the way.
No, it's a monkey.
No, it's a cat.
Oh, it's a monkey. It's a monkey. I know for a fact.
I know it's a cat for a fact.
I never argue unless I know the answer, and I'm arguing right now. You can type away.
I'm Googling this.
He's going to Google it.
Cat shit coffee beans.
No, it's monkey shit coffee beans because I tried to order them downtown one day.
The most expensive coffee in the world.
Yep. JB gets 1 point.
It's loading.
Oh, man.
All about the Kopi Luwak, the most expensive coffee in the world.
Kopi Luwak.
No, I'm just going to hit Command F and I'm going to type cat. Oh, what? There's 39.
That doesn't mean anything to me.
Things of them.
That means nothing to me. Do monkey now.
A cat-like animal called the palm civet, also the civet cat.
Oh, I fucking hate you.
I'm also now, same page, I'm going to type monkey.
Monkey.
Oh, 0 of 0 found.
Poops coffee. How did I not know that? I was going to say we should restart the episode, but that's not going to work.
Okay, now monkey poop coffee.
Well,
oh, it's the same coffee. No, okay, let's go to the Wikipedia page because that's more.
Yeah, I'm on the Wikipedia page right now. Maybe it's both. Maybe we're both right. We're really competitive.
It's a small cat-like animal.
So it's not a cat.
But it's also not a monkey. It's just kind of a, oh, God, that's an ugly fucking thing.
It's from, yeah, dude, that looks like that. If I saw that in the subway, even like I'm used to seeing like weird fucking animals up here.
His eyes are so fucking red.
That looks like Master Splinter gave an enema of the ooze to a rat and it just hasn't started like growing into like the martial artist yet.
Okay, I will put a picture of this creepy ass fucking, like it's a rat with beady red
eyes. Are you sending me the one from the Wikipedia page?
Yeah, it's like a brown.
Yeah,
rat.
I'm on it. I'm looking at it right now. This thing right here.
Yeah.
I had it open. That's what I was saying.
It's a fucking demon.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. The whole ooze with Master Splinter up the enema at us.
Oh, that is totally. It's like Master Splinter, but he has Goku powers.
So the episode that we're doing today is going to be Thrice. We're just going to get right into it because we'll just talk about this for the next fucking 3 hours.
I don't think we can honestly say we've gotten right into it.
Hi, welcome to Coffee Time with John and Aaron. Today we're talking about coffee beans that are shit out of a cat-like animal. We're going to argue for 15 minutes over whether it's a cat or a monkey. We're both going to be technically wrong. So will you admit that you were wrong? It wasn't a cat.
Will you admit you're wrong that it's not a monkey?
Yes.
Okay, then yes.
All right. So we're doing Thrice this week. So Thrice to me is one of like my all time favoriteest bands of, you know, the entire world, basically. They're not going to be like one of the ones though that like I know like every song ever and like I just absolutely love, but it's definitely like in my top 10 and definitely one of those bands that I'm always going to and listening to. What about you, Aaron?
They're really good.
Cool. That's all I wanted to hear. So Thrice is...
Okay, see you next week.
Yep. Thank you, everybody. Pop Pushu. So Thrice is basically, they're a four piece. You have a singer, he plays guitar. You have another guitarist, you have a bassist, you have a drummer. And they're a little bit harder. So like, I wouldn't say like they're metal and I wouldn't say like they're hardcore, but they definitely are not soft rock.
Well, to me, sure. they sounded a lot harder than they really are because yeah. we've come off of a little run of doing a lot of like lighter pop punk
yes.
bands.
Yes.
And I don't like hardcore.
Okay.
We'll get into that later. I have a prejudice against hardcore, and it's not really the quality of the music as much as it is. I just have a lot of bad experiences with hardcore bands.
Yeah, I mean, that's fair. So, like, and that's what it comes down to, too. Like, if you actually have, like, physical memories or if you had, like, an actual thing happen to you, like, that can affect the type of music that you like. Although, like, I wouldn't say that they run in that same circle, though. So, like, that's, like, the thing I'm trying
right.
to say.
Right. It's the thing of, like, it's not actually that hardcore, but it was close enough that it, like, triggered, like, a sense memory.
Right. And then, like, I always hate doing this. Because, like, you know, we're trying to, like, put, like, a band into a genre. We're not saying, like, we don't like doing that because, like, it's, like, we're higher than that. But I'm just saying, like, it really doesn't matter.
Well, because nothing feels accurate.
Right. It's like, also, yeah, exactly.
Even a single album, like, Out Come the Woods by Rancid
right.
has a couple ska songs on it. Right. It has a lot of punk songs, a lot right. of pop punk songs on it. So what are they as a band?
Right. So that being said, I tend to like heavier music from time to time. And Thrice kind of filled that niche. And then when I was first getting into that type of band, it was kind of like, almost like when you start eating, like, cheese and, like, you have, like, your American cheese and your Swiss cheese. And then for the first time you have, like, blue cheese. And that's a really funky flavor. It's almost like an acquired taste. That's kind of what Thrice is.
Now,
where,
is
like,
part of it you like it because your friends did, and you were like, they don't like this.
No, okay. a lot of people, you know, like, I mean, they were a big band when I was in high school, but it was just more of like, yeah, they kind of hit that, like, they're like a safe, harder band to like, to where it's like, you're not fully engulfed into that genre, if that makes any sense.
Well, it's kind of a fork in the, it's a very fork in the road band. Like, you hear this and, like, do you go left down the punk road or do you go right down the hardcore
right,
road?
And, like, I think that's awesome for them because you can't really, like, pigeonhole them. Like, you can't just say, like, this is what they are. Like, they're kind of...
They're a good blend.
Yeah. It's like when, like, two rivers meet and there's, like, salt water and there's fresh water and now it's brackish water. They're like brackish water right. When it comes to music.
It's
so kinda,
it's
cool.
Also a good nexus place of, like, it's a band that, say, you're going on a road trip with yep. your friend who loves heavy metal.
Yeah, exactly.
And you only like punk rock. And you're like, well, we'll listen to Thrice and right. like, we won't. That's neither awesome. Of us will bitch.
That makes sense. So basically, if you've never heard the band before, I think they're a great band. They're really, really catchy and then you can listen to them and their music is so complicated. It's not even funny. And they're just a good band to check out. So if you've never heard them, I definitely recommend listening to it, and I think you'll be pleasantly surprised when it comes to Thrice. So what was your first memory of Thrice?
I thought I had never heard them when I first started listening through.
Right.
I was like, none of this sounds familiar. And then it was, what is it, All That I Have Left or All That's Left or Left of All or...
You're talking about the single off of their third album.
Yeah.
All That's Left.
All That's Left.
Yep.
For the record, everyone, I already know this. I've done this in past episodes with album titles and names. Words are hard.
He keeps calling me Paul and I have to correct him that I'm John. So
we just split the middle and I call him Jones.
Yeah, he's not very good with tying the names to the actual things.
It's also, I'm not a big lyrics guy for the most part.
Right.
And I'm terrible with names and band names. Like, I'm only 27, but I'm already like your dad where I'm like, have you seen that new movie about the boat?
You're jaded.
The Tannic.
That,
like, I'm already
awesome.
Like an old fucking man.
So what is your first memory with them? Because you thought you didn't know them and then you said you realized you did. So was it that song basically?
That was on one of the Maddens, right?
Yeah, yeah. They had a couple or maybe one on like...
It was on Madden or like Burnout. Like, it was on in like an EA Sports game. So like I recognized that, but like it was a thing of like, oh yeah, right. I've heard this.
Okay, so that was actually your memory then. So you didn't think you knew them, and then as you were listening, you're like, oh, wow, I actually remember them from the Madden like video game.
Yeah, from
that's
one
awesome.
Of those, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's really cool. My first memory with them was actually back to like the Yellow Card time. So like when the Underdog EP came out for Yellow Card, Thrice was basically on their second album, which was The Illusion of Safety. And it was kind of Thrice, Yellow Card, and then there was another band called Rufio. But like those were like the big three that were pretty new. And
we've talked about this, like the upcoming triumvirate before in past episodes.
Yeah, exactly. So like they were part of that whole thing, and then they also were a lot heavier, and then that album had a song called Deadbolt, which was, it's awesome. It's super fast, and it's just like one of those ones that was awesome to see live.
Oh, Deadbolt. Yeah. That's the one you sent me that I hated.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a really, really fast song.
That
basically.
One's a little, that's one's a lot more like hardcore thrashy,
yeah,
right?
It's very, very aggressive.
Yeah, here it is. It has that super like...
It almost has like what was the Blink, like, was it M&amp's that has like that intro with the guitar that's like the same?
Oh yeah, but that was all like major chord progression, much more like poppy. This is very dark, and it's also like really screechy guitars.
Yeah,
it's not bad, but it's the thing of, like, I'm just gonna get this out of the way now,
right?
Because of why I have a thing against hardcore.
Let's do it.
So the scene that my band, Liddell, used to play in Mason City, Iowa,
okay.
We played with three types of bands.
Okay.
We played with heavy metal screaming bands that were usually Christian. Like, the most popular band from our scene was called Senseless Beauty.
Okay.
And they played, like, scream all the way through, as heavy as you can get, like, but so, it was all about God, but you can't tell what they're saying.
So they're Christian hardcore.
Christian, like, hardcore metal, and then, like, really shitty hardcore bands. And that's, like, Deadbolt, the reason I got, like, douche chills when I heard it wasn't from them. It was because as soon as I heard, like, the and then, like a quick, like, half breakdown, it just, like, gave me douche chills to seeing, like, really shitty bands in Mason City. And also, it's not even that they were bad.
Yeah.
They were also fucking assholes to us because we just played, like, pop punk and, like, slightly hardcore pop punk, but they were just fucking dicks to us. So I still have this, like, sense memory of, like, I hear that and I'm just like, oh, someone's going to try to punch me.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. It was a very cliquey scene from town to town. So, like, they kind of just kept, they looked inward to their circle. It wasn't looking outward.
Right. Well, also, like, your scene that My Getaway came out of, there's a lot more pop punk there. Because there's usually kind of like a reigning genre in every scene.
Yeah.
And ours was like hardcore screamo.
Yeah.
And they were really mean to us because we were also younger than everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. So you just tie that memory to the actual band then.
And to that sound.
Okay.
Like, yeah, that's like that hardcore sound.
Because, like, I was going to say, even with Thrice, though, like, I don't really match them up to, like, typical hardcore bands. Like, because, you know, like, any type of music you can listen to, you can almost be like, okay, like, they do, like, an intro, they do, like, a verse, they do, like, a chorus, and they do, like, a hardcore breakdown type of thing. Like, with Thrice, like, I kind of just, like, you know, they're kind of Thrice. Like, that's kind of how I always looked at them.
It's a thing of, it's the imitation.
Right.
So, like, it happens in comedy. Like, right now in the world, there is a fuck ton of comics that sound like shitty Aziz Ansari.
Well, that's
horrible. If you spend a lot of time at open mics and you're not very familiar with Aziz, you would see Aziz and you'd be like, oh, God, I hate this type of comedy.
Yeah.
And it's because everyone is imitating that sound. Thrice, like, that album, that, like, kind of, like, more thrashy sound.
Yeah.
I associate with that because they were all trying to be that.
Okay, that makes sense.
So, like, that, like, it's the imitation ruined the original. It's like when Burger King rips off McDonald's.
Right.
And, like, now I kind of don't want a Big Mac because the Big King sucked.
That's awesome. So it actually devalues the actual miserable thing. Okay, that makes a lot more sense. You know what I like, too, is, like, even if I think your thought is retarded or, like, stupid, you can back it up and explain it, and I can be like, okay, well, he's at least coming from, like, a level head.
My favorite thing about John is he'll say something, and the look on his face is, like, kind of proud of himself. He's like, I'm going to say something nice and give you a compliment. Yeah. But it starts with, if you're so dumb that if I let you go, you get smart.
That was me trying to be nice.
I know.
Just a dick.
That's what's so funny.
That's
about
awesome.
It.
But yeah, no, they were popular back then too, because the guitar work was a little bit harder. So there's Thrice. They're a four piece. They have quite a collection of albums. We're only going to talk about two today. And then moving forward in the podcast, we're going to try to focus in on one or two, or maybe like a point of a band's career, and kind of make that the focus of the episode. But they do have a pretty big discography. Their third one was probably their most well-known commercially.
Artist in the Ambulance.
We're going to touch that today. That was their first major label release. And they actually had some radio time with that. They had a little bit of an MTV flirtation going on and then faded out. And then we're also going to talk about their most recent, which came out last year in 2016. It's called To Be Everywhere and To Be Nowhere.
Oh, what is it? To Be Everywhere is To Be Nowhere?
It's To Be Everywhere is To Be Nowhere. You're correct. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Oh, look at that.
About.
I need
So you're again 2-0, man. You're
no, 3-0. Let's keep it rolling from episode.
What was the? We're going to keep track from all the episodes.
Well, the other two are from episode 0.
I hate it, man. I hate when you're tallying it up. Fuck.
You're
dude.
The one who started keeping track.
Because I'm competitive, Aaron. And I don't like to lose.
It's also the thing of you also never count points against me. You only count the ones against you, and I just remember you holding it against yourself.
I'm trying to build a case here that Aaron's a bully. I just want everybody to know that. If I'm afraid of Aaron, I'm going to blink twice. You don't know if I do or not. It's a podcast, so you don't know. So they had a lot of releases. We're only going to cover those two.
Right. Well, because it's something we've kind of learned doing these couple episodes. John put it really well after we did our first episode. See, John. I'll give you points if you want points.
I don't want that point.
You want to play at midnight? We'll play fucking at midnight.
I don't want that point.
See, now he's pouting, guys. But like John brought it up after we did a couple demo episodes we never put out.
Yeah.
And he made a really good point. We would try to cover a band like A to like Z, their whole catalog.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he put it like it's like a, you're in high school trying to write a paper over World War II. And you can't write a paper all of World War II. But if you talk about like a battle on a certain day, it's a lot easier.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're limiting our scope more these days.
Yeah, it's a lot easier when you can just narrow it down. And then also, too,
to
like...
point, John.
Also, too, you know, the things we're going to talk about, too, are kind of the more popular aspects of the band versus us just covering
and also the things we like and know the most, too. Because we're already going to talk out of our ass. Let's talk out of our ass at least accurately.
Absolutely. That being said, let's throw on something from Artists in the Ambulance.
Let's throw on my favorite song, which is the one off of Madden. Let's throw on All That's Left.
Cool. Let's do it. Hey guys, we hope you're enjoying the show. If you are, it would help us out a lot if you could rate, review, and subscribe in iTunes or however else you get your podcasting fix. Or better yet, just tell somebody you know via word of mouth. It goes a lot farther than you think.
Hey everybody, if you want to get in contact with us here at the show, you can find us on Twitter at @podpunkshow. Our email address is podpunkshow@gmail.com. Thank you so much for listening. Back to the show. All right, welcome back into the podcast. We took a little break there. So one of the big albums that John wanted me to listen to for my research on this was Artists in the Ambulance. It's a good album all the way through. There's a couple songs in it that are heavier than my tastes, but I can tell that it is really good hardcore.
Yeah, no, it's like a good mix.
So what was this one that drew you to like, hey, if we're going to do Thrice, we have to do this album?
Well, the main thing was it's right in that time period where I'm getting into like music and I'm learning how to play guitar and just like it's a good point in your life, basically. So it's got good memories tied with that. And then it's their third album. So at this point, like they know what Thrice is. They know like what they want it to be. Mm-hmm. And they've done enough as a band to be signed to a major record label and then get a chance at doing that type of release.
Totally. It's a weird thing too of your first couple albums, like you're technically good. You know how to play well.
Right.
Also, with something that drew you to Thrice is that it's a very skillful guitar playing. Like it's not just like the Ramones, like three chords. That, like you actually like the like technical difficulty.
No, I mean, to be honest with you, I never really cared about that. I respect it, but I never really... You know, that wasn't my initial draw to the actual
You weren't one
band.
Of those guitar players that, like, love, like, Yngwie and, like, crazy
oh,
stupid.
Oh, no, I absolutely wasn't. I was really all about, like, catchy music. Like, that's really what
I'm Oh, good. Because, like, you remember Dragon Force?
Yeah, I do remember they Dragon Force. They
garbage.
Were nuts. Yeah.
There was one of those bands.
They were, like, weren't they, like, a super band from Sweden or something?
Yeah, and everything was, like, a constant guitar solo.
That being said, and I have no idea what I'm talking about, but Thrice apparently has some crazy time signatures and some really, really complicated guitar work. I mean, I respect, but I look at that as almost like a, when you look at science, it's like rocket science. Yeah. So like if you're another rocket scientist, you can appreciate what's going on. But to everybody else, it's just a rocket taking off. You know what I mean? But I like this one because it's definitely major label, but they're also like, they're not trying to make something that's just like pure radio, basically.
No, not at all. And also my theory of the lyrical content of this album is, it is all about the self-awareness of selling out.
Yeah, no, that's definitely a
lyrical theme.
Because
the first song is called, what is it, like Cold Hearts and Cold Cash or Cold Cash and Cold Hearts.
Right.
God, I sound so much like your dad. Of like, it's chili dollars and cold dimes.
It's called Cold Cash and Colder Hearts.
Okay. Like that song to me is very much about the capitalist nature of the music business.
Yeah, and like that's another thing too. And like this was also something that goes on with Thrice, and it wasn't my draw to them. I still don't. It doesn't tickle my fancy, I guess is the wording to say. Oh, that's so horrible. But they're very deep with their lyrics, but they're also like opinionated and almost like in a political way. So
they're definitely not afraid to be political. They're also intelligent. They're intelligent in a way where it's not pompous, but they're way too smart.
They're the rocket scientists of punk. I mean, that's what it comes down to.
Because their album after The Artist in the Ambulance is Visu.
Yep.
And which is a reference to a Tom and Pynchon novel.
Yeah.
Like it's like they're just book nerds.
Yeah, and it wasn't too like there's some bands out there at the time that were like saying like they listened to like this specific poet. It was just more like a gimmick. This is just how they are. So that's what's pretty cool about it.
Right. This isn't a front.
So the other thing I really appreciate with this album, and I remember it, there's a thing that used to happen when somebody would put out an album and they would put out a CD and it would come with like an actual package that you would get and open up.
Mm-hmm.
And it would basically have some thought put into it. And that was kind of the process of actually getting like new music.
Oh, that's a big thing with this album.
Yeah. The actual packet What is it called, I guess?
Eco-pack.
An eco-pack? Is that what it is?
One of the ones where it's like all one piece, but it's not like a jewel case?
Yeah. So yeah, like
eco-pack or eco something.
It was really awesome. So basically it had like no booklet, but everything in it was like a really like thick format postcard. And it was incredible. And like the album kind of has a space theme to it. So you got this like beautiful album. It had actual artwork inside it. You would pull it out. The whole packaging process was absolutely amazing. And that's something like it sticks out. Like I'm thinking back to other bands, like even bands I like more than Thrice, and I don't really have many albums that like kind of you remember in your head and you're like, oh my God, that's amazing.
And you remember like the feel of the liner notes.
Yeah, no, it was really, really well put together. And so it was part of the whole package there, but it's a really good album. What are some songs that kind of stood out to you, especially since like Thrice isn't really your thing?
Well, just quickly to finish up my theory earlier about this album is about selling out. Chili Dollars, Cold Hearts.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
I'm not going to get it right. I'm going to give up on getting that right. That's all about the awareness of what selling out means. Artists in the Ambulance is all about realizing that they can take the money they earn by playing into the system
right.
to use for good, which is something they do. Every album they have from Artists in the Ambulance mm-hmm. on forward, they donate a percentage of the profits from each album to charity.
Yeah, it's amazing.
So like they kind of realize like, okay, if we just lean a little bit into the system,
yeah.
we can actually do good with it.
Yeah, no, it's awesome.
Compared to just being a band that's like, well, we stuck by our morals. Yeah, but you didn't change anything.
Like I remember too, when Artists in the Ambulance came out, it was on Island Records. So like they were kind of like on a streak back then of signing like punk bands out of the scene.
And Island used to be, now they're like part of Columbia or something. Like Island used to be like one of the like top four labels.
Oh yeah, it was huge. It was Island Def Jam, I think at the time was the two. But Island was actually matching whatever they were going to donate to charity. And like that was like kind of known with the whole thing too. So it was really cool. But it's coming from an actual legit place.
But Artists in the Ambulance, that song is a great song.
Yeah, that was like their main single from the entire album.
Let's play a little clip of that just to get that.
Late night brakes, I hear the tires squeal. Red light can't stop, so I spin the wheel. My world goes black before I feel an angel lift me up. And I open bloodshot eyes into fluorescent white. Flip the siren, hit the lights, close the doors, and I am gone.
And also, the singing on this is much more coherent. Like, the lyrics have always been good, but you can hear what he's saying a lot more.
Yeah, it's definitely, he's basically mastered. He has like a black belt in singing now.
Right.
Like, he knows what he's doing with his voice.
But it's still, like, it still has, like, a good fucking, like, he has a headbang to it.
He has a great voice, too.
Oh, he has such a unique voice, but not in, like, a, like, bad way.
Yeah, exactly.
Also, that lead part, like, that's really high up.
Yeah.
It almost sounds like, it's one of those guitar tones that you listen to, and it's almost like a synth.
Yeah.
Because it's so consistent.
No, I know what you mean. And, like, the other thing, too, and this is all memories, and, like, this is me kind of knowing guitar, but, like, not knowing, like, actual, you know, things with it. I do remember, like, seeing them live, and it was always weird because their lead guitarist, his name is Tepe. He's, like, this Japanese guy. But he would always play, like, the crazy leads, and he had, like, a Fender. And, like, you don't see, like, heavy lead guys. They usually have, like, a Gibson.
Or, especially with this kind of, like, more metal-y sound, they play, like, a Jackson.
Or, like, an Ibanez or something like that.
Yeah, something that's known for metal.
I just remember, like, as like whenever you see a Telecaster, like, you're kind of, like, associating it with, like, a certain style. It was always kind of cool.
More middle of the road. Sound. Yeah. Like, when you say Stratocaster, I think of three things. I think of the 1950s. I think of Eric Clapton. And I think of John Mayer.
Right, yeah. So, like, anybody that plays guitar kind of knows what I'm talking about. Is, like, when you see, like, a lead guitarist, it's very rare that you kind of see them rocking out on a Telecaster.
Well, there's guitars really have a lot of identity politics.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, I always played Fender jazz basses, not Fender Precision. Fender Precision basses are known for being like the go-to rock bass.
Right.
I always played Fender jazz basses. They have a thinner neck.
Yeah.
I do have big hands, but that would allow me to go from the first fret all the way to the fifth fret with like one hand.
Okay.
Which on a bass, like bass is like you have like normal size hands. You have like guitar player hands.
These hands are huge.
I don't know if I've ever showed you this. If you line up the bottoms of my wrists, mm-hmm. my left hand, since I started playing bass before I finished growing,
right.
is about, what would you say, half an inch longer than my right?
Yeah, but that's everybody. Your dominant hand is always shorter than your non-dominant
hand. Oh, really?
That's a human thing.
Oh, damn it. You just ruined a story I used to tell at parties.
Well, let's hear it.
Oh, you just heard it. It's like, oh, I started playing bass when I was 10 years old, and that's why this hand from stretching for frets is so much longer.
That was that's also like one of the theories they thought was since you use your dominant hand all the time, it doesn't get as long.
Mm.
But there's something going on with like genetics, and that's kind of like where it ends up.
I know it's usually a little bit, but like I've had other people do it too, like right next to me. but like mine has like a huge noticeable difference.
Yeah, no, they're usually it's all two scale, but it's usually like a quarter inch, kind of half inch, you know. But yeah, that's
I'm cutting this out of the podcast so I can keep it for my stories. I'm not even joking.
John 1,
Aaron 3.
That's right.
The thing I like so much about this album too is that there's a lot of air.
Yeah.
There's parts where it is like you can, like if you cut, like if you just repeated like a bar of the song over and over, like you can hear just drums and vocals.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
A lot of heavier bands always feel the need to constantly be playing.
Right.
And everyone's, that's why the reason I don't like metal, I never bridge, a lot of people start with punk.
Right.
And as they grow up, they go more metal and heavier.
Right.
I don't like a lot of metal because it's just wall-to-wall guitar.
Yeah, no, it's just nonstop. But, and the other thing too,
nonstop.
The other thing I like with this album too is it's a good mix of, they have like their singles and it's kind of radio. There's still Thrice though in those. And then there's other songs in the album that are just like freaking nonstop aggression, like from start to finish.
That would never be on the radio.
Yeah, that would never get on the radio.
And none of them feel that they don't belong on this album.
That's what I was going to say. Like they're both living under the same roof and they're both getting along. Like it's exactly. a really cool album.
They're very, they feel natural. Like when you go from what is it? All That I Have Left, All That's Left.
All That's
Guys,
Left.
Guys, I'm you're, this
horrible
isn't,
with everything when it comes to names.
Isn't a bit.
Yeah, no, it's not.
But then you go into like Paper Tigers, which is fucking, that's a mosh pit that gets a little dangerous.
Oh yeah, no, I mean like one of my best memories at a live show was Paper Tigers. They closed with that and they did like the whole Braveheart scene where they break the pit down and split it down the middle and then run it back in.
Well, you split the pit and like it was awesome. It flashes, like,
and
like fucking,
it got so crazy, the House of Blues like had a throw the extra guys that are normally like lifeguards up on the post to look down. They all had to get into the floor. Oh my God, it was fucking amazing. That was sweet.
I've been to like three concerts. I saw Rancid.
Yeah.
At like it's a big like concert venue in Minneapolis. And yeah. They were playing with, I think it was Sick of It All.
Okay.
I think it was a heavier band. Like it was more like straight East Coast fucking hardcore. Like, you know, when like people mosh with balled up fists.
Yeah, no, I know. They're
and
out
they,
there.
They split the floor.
Ugh.
And I was right in the middle of it.
Oh my God.
Let's talk moshing really quick.
Yeah. Is that something you would do?
Oh fuck. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's actually the thing that I miss most about like local shows and
right.
stuff. But my problem was I'm a huge guy, but I'm also kind of like a big dumb sweetheart.
Yeah. Like you're like the ogre that's super nice.
So like I have a memory of that same Rancid show. During Rancid, I was in the circle pit.
Right.
And someone dropped their glasses.
Yeah.
And they were about to like, not even thinking about it, this kid was about to go down and pick up his glasses. I'm like, oh, you're going to get trampled to death.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So I saw this. He was right in front of me. I stopped and like almost like a boulder in water.
Right.
I stood in front of him while he got his glasses so everyone would bounce off me like around him.
Oh,
to
that's
give him,
awesome.
Like, a safe space.
You were like Groot to help him.
Mm-hmm. No, totally.
Yeah.
And like he got up and like he looked at me and goes, thank you. Like I couldn't hear him, but I could see he said thank you.
Right.
And I nodded and I picked him up and just like shoved him.
Shoved
like,
him back in.
Let's go.
Yeah, that's awesome. The other thing I love too is like whenever somebody would fall, it was like a big deal and everybody would stop and be responsible and make sure they're okay and not, you know, trampled.
Well, it's always the thing of, if you're ever in a mosh pit, like if you're a younger kid and you're listening to this and like you haven't been to a lot of big concerts,
mm-hmm.
here's who you need to fear in a mosh pit. Anyone over 35.
Yeah.
Because if they are still in a mosh pit, it's because they want to hurt something. any guy with a jacket that has no sleeves.
That's a weird one.
And if you're at a punk show, skinheads. Skinheads are a real thing. If you see a skinhead with a jacket with no sleeves that's over 35, he is there to feel something by hurting you.
That's like the unicorn. You want to stay away from that one.
Yeah, that guy might as well be an assassin.
Yeah. No, that's absolutely true.
I've seen some fucked up shit in some pits, but pits are safe.
Yeah, it's just nuts. Like when you think about it, like what's going on in like your brain at that time? Like it's like you're being completely reckless. You're just slamming into people and it doesn't hurt. It's completely fine.
I'm sure there's like some sexual thing of like, I just want to fucking break things. So, but no, Artist in the Ambulance as an album is solid. It really helped me get over kind of my grudges I was holding against hardcore. Because I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot. I just saw the shit version of this.
No, that's awesome. And yeah, it's a really, really well put together album. Like it's definitely one of my favorite albums of all time. I love it.
This is a segment I wanted to get into. Because we do a disclaimer at the beginning where we talk about we don't really care about genre. We're not going to here to tell you whether Sum 41 is punk or pop punk. We don't fucking care what you call it.
Right, exactly.
This goes back to my theory. Even when I was 14, I was smart enough to go, you know what's not punk? Arguing about what's punk. And that's the only thing on the list.
That's awesome. No, that's just really awesome. That's
but
like
just
a,
to kind of place genre, to kind of categorize things, mm-hmm. I kind of look at there's thrash and there's hardcore.
But what do you mean by thrash though? Because like I was using that term, but like I have no idea what it means.
Okay, Metallica's first album, Kill 'Em All, is okay. thrash.
So like what makes it thrash though? Is it just like the aggression with it, or is it just like it's like jerky guitar riffs? Like what is that?
It's very, it's closer to metal. It's a lot heavier.
Okay.
It's
okay. So it's like jerky.
Slayer is thrash.
Okay.
And hardcore, but is also a lot of times thrash and hardcore to me are the same level of heaviness.
Okay.
Here's the difference to me.
Okay.
This is my view. This isn't scientific.
Right.
Thrash are bands that have the talent and skill level. Not talent. I don't like, talent is a very flexible thing.
Mm-hmm.
Thrash bands have the musical skill level of a punk band, but want to be a metal band.
Okay, so it's not technical then is what you're trying
right.
to say. Okay.
They have, like, their heart is metal, but their hands are punk.
Okay.
Like, on the frets. A hardcore band, their heart beats fucking in, like, punk time.
Yeah.
But their hands know how to play metal.
Okay.
So they're dumbing themselves down almost, or they're trying to slow down. And that's really the difference between thrash and hardcore to me.
Okay, that makes perfect sense.
So, like,
sense.
Slayer, they are fucking balls to the wall metal, but right. a lot of their stuff, like, yes, it's very difficult to play, but it's not very... music theory wise, like super intelligent.
Okay.
But it's awesome. Like Slayer kicks ass.
Well,
like,
I mean, that was what I was saying though before with Thrice is their timings and like the actual music theory that they're putting into their songs, it's like next level. Like it's absolutely
almost as good
insane.
As like Tool. Tool is a band. I don't know if you like Tool, but it's like.
I know of them. I never really got into them.
I love Tool, but okay. it's a band where you're like, you have to be brilliant to be able to play at that level.
Okay.
Even if it's not your thing, you can look at it and you go like, I know that this takes a lot of talent
right.
and skill.
So it's the rocket science.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
It's very much rocket science. But that's kind of my overarching
And like
theory.
The other thing too with rocket science is it's really only interesting to other rocket scientists. Nobody else can kind of appreciate it.
I know a lot of people who like love really intense guitar but can't play.
Yeah, but I'm just saying like it's kind of like a niche is what I'm trying to say. Like the casual listener isn't going into that. And
oh yeah.
Yeah, they're like, oh my
popular
God.
Popular masses.
Oh my God, is that a 1711 time structure? How do they do that? I don't even know if that's a
that
real.
Would sound like garbage.
Yeah, that would be no good. So
the reason I don't like math rock or mathcore.
What is that? Like, what's a band that's a mathcore band?
Oh, I don't know any because I don't like it. You have to Google it.
That's awesome.
Like, it's something that it's a big thing Tool does where they do polyrhythm.
Okay.
The drummer can play. Their drummer's insane. He can play with his arms in 4/4 time, and he can play with his feet, his pedals in 3/4 time. But that matches up in a weird
That's
way.
So
where
crazy.
It could clash.
Yeah.
But like mathcore will be like, they'll play like the first two bars in like 4/4 time, the second two bars, and then they'll play in 5/4 and then 6/4. And like they'll keep doing this where it's like, yeah, if I'm listening to music, I don't want to count.
No, exactly. But when you were saying before, like he can play with his feet, I got like a quick image of like a dude with drumsticks between his big toe and his like next toe. And he's also playing with his fans.
I mean, if he could figure out how to hold them, I'm sure he would.
That'd be awesome. That's something that somebody should try to do.
Yeah. Well, so, the drummer from Def Leppard, he plays half his drum set with his feet because he has one arm.
Oh, yeah. No, that's absolutely crazy. He's missing what? Like his right arm or his left arm?
I think it's his right arm.
Did he lose it in the war? Or like how did he lose his arm?
Car accident, I think. I'm going off of information I saw on a Behind the Music 10 years ago.
We have no idea what we're talking about.
And you know what's really funny? We have broadband.
Oh, yeah, no, we could look any of this up right in front of us.
But since Def Leppard's not a punk band and it's not the thing that eats coffee beans and shits them out, we don't care.
We don't give a shit. We're not trying to prove each other wrong. It's like, it's basically when one of us wants to challenge the other one, that's when we like get go time.
Right, it's the thing of if John said he knew how it happened and that's not what I remembered, I'd call him on it. But since neither of us know, we just go, okay.
Yeah, and I just threw in the war. That could be anything. You know, the war. The punk war of the 1980s.
He lost the hair metal or the hairspray war?
The hairspray war. You know, Judas Priest.
You know he's a Tresemme man.
Absolutely.
Don't get out of here with that fucking Aquanet. Tresemme.
What, do you use Tresemme?
I use the shampoo sometimes.
You don't use the hairspray?
Dude, look at my hair. What the fuck do I need hairspray for?
Your hair looks kind of layered. It looks like it's got some technique into it.
No.
I was going to ask you which one you use. They have like 1 through 5 ratings. Something
oh, like the heavy hold. Back when I had a mohawk, I used the stuff that was just called hair concrete.
Was it a gel or was it an actual spray?
It was a gel, but it was almost like gritty.
So you actually would buy whatever it was to put in your hair for the mohawk?
Yeah, my hair would just stay like I couldn't sleep a certain direction because it would stab into my head.
That's hilarious. Like everybody I knew would just use Elmer's glue and they would just put it in their hair.
Everyone told me that after I got rid of my mohawk.
What else do we have to say about this?
There are some songs on it that I don't like, and it's not a quality issue. It's a like I'm a very tricky man of what I like.
Do you not like them because it's like the harder songs, or what is like the feeling?
I'm not big on heavy. Like
okay. So the heavier songs in the album just don't do it for you.
Right. And like even Tool, there's a lot of stuff. Like I only like a handful of Tool, like really like a handful of Tool songs.
Yes.
They're a heavy band, but
Yeah, no, this album, it's almost
tricky with that.
This album's almost like day and night with some of their songs, where there's like the daytime songs, which are a little bit more poppier, and then there's the nighttime songs, which are just like straight up like going at it the entire time.
Well, listening to this album, the first time I listened to it, I didn't like it, and I was listening to it on shuffle.
Oh, really? No, you can't do that.
Because then you'll go right from like one of the lighter songs
yeah.
into like Paper Tigers.
Yeah, I mean, the album doesn't have like a complete structure to it, which it probably does, but it doesn't have like one that like just like stands out. But it also definitely is one that you kind of want to like listen from start to finish the way it's set up.
Well, the thing of like the way they do it with these soft songs, these heavy songs, the back and forth,
mm-hmm.
is that it never goes from the softest to the hardest. Like it has an up, it has a rise and fall.
Yes.
But the first time I listened to it, I'd listen to like the All Left, whatever song that I can't figure out the name of today.
All That's Left.
All That's Left. Why do I want to keep throwing All That I Have Left in there?
I have no idea. I love it because it's like the eighth time that you've tried to say it. It's so
I'm
awesome.
I just want to
write like a note card and just stick it like right in front of you.
I feel like it's like almost like adorable, like a dumb cat where I'm like, I'm trying so hard to get it right every time too.
He's trying. Just let him do it.
Like you can see this like look of panic in my eyes when it comes up.
Just let him do
but
it.
But when you go from like that song to Paper Tigers, like yeah. on shuffle, Paper Tigers is like, ugh, that's heavy. If you're not into heavy.
Yeah. Well, Paper Tigers is heavy compared to anything.
Right. But
album,
like,
but yeah.
it's when you put those back to back, but like, I didn't like this album until the third time through. I almost was going to John, I don't know if I can do this episode because I'm not going to have a lot to contribute.
That's funny.
Until the third time through, I'm like, oh, what if I just turn shuffle off
and just listen to it the way it should be listened
and
to.
I was like, this album is genius.
Yeah, no, it's a really really
even
solid
Odyssey
album.
The Ambulance sounds a little too heavy if it's wrong to the next to the wrong song, but like
yeah,
but like
that's fair.
I love albums that have that where like there's a structure. Like your first couple albums as a band when you're trying to get big or when you're trying to get signed,
right,
you always wait your best songs first.
Yeah, you kind of just throw it out there because you don't think the guy's going to listen past one song.
Right, and I hate that. I like when there's like a song where like this sounds like, oh, this is the opening curtain to the album.
Right, no, that's cool. Yeah, and definitely, like it's got structure. The songs are, they know their parts and they're building it up to like do what they need to do.
And that to me is the difference between like an album as far as, oh, this is just our songs right now, and an
right.
album of like, this is a piece of music together.
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you mean by that. So looking back at the album, it came around though, something that you actually like to listen to?
No, I like... you're not a big streaming guy with your music. Like you like to buy
yeah,
albums.
Yeah, no,
still.
I have a control issue. So.
Yeah. Well, you're a record store guy. I'm not a record store guy.
Yeah.
I have Spotify, and every month I make this playlist of songs.
Okay.
Songs that are new to me.
Yeah.
They're usually a little older because like there's not a lot of new pop punk.
Right.
But I make this playlist every month. It's just like May 2017. That way I can go back to kind of like, oh, last year I had a really bad month. I was unemployed. I can go back. What was I listening to then?
Okay, that makes sense.
But Thrice made it on that list.
Oh, wow.
That's actually how I learn new music is I listen to those playlists a lot of new songs. So like I remember the names of new bands.
So it's almost like a time hop where you look like a year back and kind of see where you're at.
Exactly. But okay. it also reinforces of like bands I hadn't heard before. And they would be like, oh, I heard it once on like the radio function on Spotify. I never heard it again. But now I remember. Because I listened back to that playlist a lot.
Okay.
But Thrice made it on that. Like, Artist in the Ambulance made it on the list.
Okay, that's cool.
All That's Left.
You got it.
It's going to make it hurt so much more next time.
I know, right? So that made it onto the list. Did any of the other ones from the album make it on?
Off of this one, also, I can't remember what it's called. There's like two more. There was four off this one, and there was three off their newer album.
Okay, but you're making these lists.
Yeah, these are my basically like my bookmarks of like I want to learn more about these bands or memorize. These are songs I want to bring into my life because I had a bad problem for a lot of years, especially after leaving the band. I didn't listen to a lot of new music.
Yeah,
I was still listening to like the same like 20 albums I listened to when I was 16.
But yeah, when it comes to like Spotify, It definitely took the place of the radio there. And like, I just kind of missed jumping back on that bandwagon. Cause like, you know, everybody for the long time was finding their music through either radios or you'd go to a record store and they'd have like a top 10 wall or MTV would kind of tell you what to listen to and what was cool. Then the iPod came out and people just started illegally downloading music and storing it
and
kind
it
of
used
creating
to be like LimeWire, Kazaa, where do you find new stuff?
Yeah. And you would basically go out and look for what you wanted to get. I kind of never left that era. So like when Spotify and all that Apple Music and started coming out and taking over, I just never got on that bandwagon.
Well, it's also this thing of every time you and I talk about like, dude, you need to get Spotify.
Yeah.
And I kind of give you my pitch.
Yeah.
Every time you're like, I just got to do that. Like the playlist thing and the like, what's it like, knows your music taste and it can recommend stuff to you.
Yeah. No, it makes sense. Like everybody I talk to has it. I just.
No, and every time you're like, I'm going to do that. And then next time I see you, it's almost like you fall, like you're a speedometer and I get you up to like 45 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And next time I see you, you're back at zero.
Well, yeah. Like the minute something else happens, like it could just be a butterfly going by. My intention is completely gone. So
yeah, and it's not the good. Thing of I figure sooner or later you'll get on there, but
yeah,
it's...
I still find new music though. People recommend me stuff and I listen to it. So
all right, so we're gonna go out. We're gonna go to our second break here a little bit, and we're gonna play a little bit of Black Honey off of the new Thrice album.
Sounds good.
Which, if you only know the old Thrice, this song is gonna blow your mind that it's Thrice.
They're like a fine wine; they just get better as they age.
It is a really good album.
It's amazing.
This is even an album that my wife would like, and she doesn't like anything.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. So that's why this episode I wanted to kind of talk about two albums, which is something we normally don't kind of hit
on. And also, this is basically their first like real We Have Our Shit Together album, and their most recent.
It's definitely, it's their most recent, and it's kind of cool because there's almost a 10-year gap. There's more than a 10-year gap between the one we just talked about and the one we're going to talk about.
Absolutely. So here's a little of Black Honey. A little more deep on To Be Everywhere Is To Be Nowhere.
Yeah, we're going to follow up with the second album that we're going to cover in this episode. So normally we would kind of just like look at one episode and kind of like really dive into it. Or not one episode, one album. Kind of dive into it and really focus on a specific time. But this one, we kind of want to hit the two of them because they're both really, really good albums.
It's kind of like A, B, and of like showing. And it's also, they're so different albums.
Yeah, they're completely different. They're more than 10 years apart. And it definitely shows like how the band's evolved and how they're different.
So let me defer to you quick, since you are the Thrice fan. When did you first hear To Be Everywhere Is To Be Nowhere?
I heard it like when it came out. So basically, I pre-ordered it on iTunes, so iTunes didn't run out of it, and I couldn't get it. So dumb. And then I listened to it the first day it came out, and I was like, "Holy fucking shit, this is awesome!"
You liked it right away?
Oh yeah, and like because like you know like iTunes will put out like one or two tracks.
Yeah.
And so when I heard those tracks, like I was just like, "This is freaking amazing!"
Do you remember what the two early tracks were?
I don't remember exactly, but it was probably like Black Honey, or it was either like whatever the opening track is on it. That's Hurricane or Blood in the Sand.
Yeah, so we went out to the break on Black Honey. We came back in on Blood in the Sand. I want to touch on those songs more specifically too.
Yeah, those are like two ones that I wanted to focus in on because they're fantastic.
They're like these. They would be the singles off this album.
Yeah, and then the other one I like is Stay With Me is fantastic on it. It's just it's an awesome album.
It's great, but it's so because I was curious what you thought of it as like a old school Thrice fan because like you heard Artists in the Amos back in the day.
You know me too. Like I'm a little bit more of a details guy. You like to just enjoy life. I like to overthink. So
I overthink a lot too. I just don't do it with my music.
Exactly. So basically they had taken a hiatus. So they were like 2012-ish, 2013-ish. Mm-hmm. They kind of stopped. It wasn't a breakup though. Like they basically said like we are going to get back together at some point. But
this was a planned intentional hiatus.
And this was like after their seventh release. So like they basically kind of I think were just you know, tapped out when it comes creativity wise. And they kind of wanted to start focusing on their families, maybe moving to different areas. They kind of have an actual life.
Oh, I can't imagine. Cause my band never got that far. Like the idea of,
yeah, no, it's a full-time job because
and touring, like real extensive touring. Yeah, I can't imagine stamina.
It weighs on you. It's not something you clock in and clock out. Like it's basically 24/7.
Well, you have to like pour yourself out on stage every night.
And then you get wasted out when it comes to actual thoughts and like how you're feeling with music. So they took a break and it was a short one. In less than 2 years, they were basically back at it. Started writing.
Fair. They went not because also a lot of people don't realize like the touring schedule. Like you know when the band comes to your town. Like if you live in Memphis, you know like okay they come here about once a year. What you don't realize is like some 41. Like they still play like 200, 300 shows a year.
It's insane.
And like the only time they take downtime is then they go right into a studio. They write an album. Yeah. They record an album and they go right the fuck back out.
Yeah, you have to. You have to keep momentum. It's absolutely insane. But
if you haven't seen that band come through your town in like 3 years, you think oh man they probably aren't doing nothing. Like
you
always
you relate it to yourself like.
Time is a personal scale.
Absolutely. And then also, too, like they weren't not putting out albums before that. They basically had a new release every 14 to 16 months. So like almost every year and a half, they had another big one coming out. So they took a break. They put out this. And I honestly, I think it's their best album of all time.
It's great. I like this one of the two. I like a lot. Like,
right.
I don't want to reveal until we kind of get to our verdicts at the end.
How would you compare this album to Artist in the Ambulance?
It's so hard because it doesn't even sound like the same band. Because I also, because I had to like cram my research in over the week between last episode and this episode.
Right.
I listened to Artist in the Ambulance. I listened to this one.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like did a little quick, like I'd play a random track off of ones in between.
Yes.
So I wasn't there for like the in between, like that growth. Like it's a, one day I saw a baby tree and then I saw a full grown tree and I didn't see it in between, like a time lapse.
So when you're comparing this album to Artist in the Ambulance, the big note that I take from it is just that the sound is more consistent and realized. And that not saying like Artist in the Ambulance doesn't know like what they're trying to do, but like there's like some songs that are radio, there's some songs that are not radio, there's some songs that are hard, there's some not hard. This album kind of like from start to finish is basically going to stay in the same frames of consistency when it comes to like the
actual. Well, there's kind of two dimensions at play in a lot of things I think about. Like for an example of how I think about things, like my knowledge of music is narrow but deep. Like I don't know a lot of bands and I don't know a lot of different types of music, but what I do know, I know a lot about.
Right.
Like I can tell you every album of Rancid, most of the tracks I could probably still name and like their whole history.
Okay.
And like that kind of scene I know a lot about. I don't know a lot about just like general music.
Okay.
Now, when I look at Artists in the Ambulance, that is a very narrow type of music and very narrow skill set of what the, like bag of tricks they're using.
Sure.
But then you listen to Be Everywhere, it's a much more broad, but it's also fairly deep. It's not like they're going shallow in all types of music, but they're kind of expanding their purview of what they can do. And like,
and again, that's natural. I mean, it's over 10 years later of a release. You would hope a band would kind of, you know, develop and flesh out and kind of experiment. And their albums in between, too, were a couple of them were really experimental. So like they kind of got like a little weird. But it was always still Thrice. So
they did kind of that Bad Religion thing. Bad Religion in the 80s, they had an album called Into the Unknown, which they had only been releasing like straight, almost like straight edge, like hardcore punk songs. Mm-hmm. Then they did Into the Unknown, which was all like prog rock and they had like synths and stuff.
Right. But like, was it like a complete shakeup where it's almost like a 180? So they never, they never really did that as Thrice. But they definitely, they kind of experimented and got out of like their comfort zone.
What's funny about that Bad Religion album, Into the Unknown,
mm-hmm.
Their next album was called Back to the Known.
Oh, that's funny.
And what's really funny, too, is for the longest time, Into the Unknown is now still, I think, only available on like the entire box set. They don't sell just that album. And that album, for years and years, you could not find anywhere.
That's funny.
Because it was such a, like...
Was that them, like, just, like, acknowledging that it was bad and they didn't want it? Or was it just, like, it just didn't go over well?
Both.
Yeah.
I think it was a little bit of both. But like,
that's awesome.
Because I know Visu, the one after this one, has a lot more synth, has a lot more...
Yeah.
And like playing around,
and then in between that too, not in between that, but after Visu, they basically put out four EPs that kind of add into like one longer normal album.
Right. It was like a compartmentalized concept album.
Yeah, it's very concept-y, and basically each album is a different element, and then when you actually listen to it, it kind of like makes that element kind of like the focal point of what they're.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not too crazy, but when you do listen to it, like some albums will have like electronic drums in it, and they don't have that in the other ones. So they do this album. I agree with you. It's got a lot more layers. It's got a lot more flavor coming in, but it's the right flavors, not just adding something to add it in.
Like, for example, like the song Salt and Shadow
mm-hmm.
is very atmospheric. Like it almost like reminds me of almost like a Radiohead song where like it almost sounds like a, like, how do you describe atmosphere? Like it sounds very expansive and it's very drawn out.
Yeah. And like, I can sum it up perfectly. It's the final song on the album. So it's like their epic. So it's kind of like it's their grand finale and like, they're just going to go out and it's built up really well. It's a really, really good final song.
It's also a song that like, if you listen to it on like 5.1 surround sound with your eyes closed stoned, it'd be like a journey.
That's awesome. And then, basically, this album to me is almost like they took Xanax and it's now in their system.
Yeah, actually, in my notes I have, if you listen to Artists in the Ambulance and then listen to Be Everywhere, back to back, it sounds like someone stopped drinking Jolt Cola and just took a bunch of weed pops.
They're done with Mountain Dew, man, and weed's legal. Listen to it,
right.
Man.
Like, this album is so much more a weed album than Artists in, like, Artists in the Ambulance, if you listen to that on weed, you'd have a panic attack.
There's some parts in it. And that was the other thing, too. I was cracking up because... when we pick the album, like, we kind of dive into it and we kind of listen to it and really like get into it. And I was texting Aaron and I was like, man, like, this album's going to end up killing me. Like, my heartbeat's like 135 beats per minute because it's so quick. So it was a nice change up to kind of get to this album. And it's definitely more chill. But this is a great, solid album. Really mature. no longer defined by punk or metal or anything, you know, stupid like that.
Almost anything. It has more of a, this is a term I would almost always use as a pejorative, but in this time, I mean only as a descriptor and as a positive. Like, to be everywhere is, and the whole album title is To Be Everywhere is To Be Nowhere. I know that.
Right.
I'm not going to say that every time. I know this one. I know All That's Left I Have.
Right.
I know I'm going to fuck that song title up.
Yeah, no, All That's Left. He got it right twice now, so that's good. He's 2 for 8. Yes, 1/4 of the time, every time.
I don't think that adds up.
Who cares?
But this has almost more of a modern rock feel. Like, I could hear this on like a modern rock station and it wouldn't feel out of place, but it would also feel different and special. Unlike,
yeah,
like this isn't like Seether, where it's garbage.
Well, that was always like Thrice, though. It's like they're not really pigeonholed into any specific genre. They're always just Thrice, but they kind of just like, they do work with like multiple things. And it's cool now, too, because like one of my friends just saw Thrice. They came through Florida and they were playing like a really, really, really hardcore metal festival. But then you could equally see Thrice like on the Warped Tour and it would work out perfectly. So like, it's just like one of those bands that kind of like, they don't really care. They just do their thing and it's really cool. So I like that they're not purposely trying to be different, but they are a different band.
I want to do a little bit of just kind of 3 songs off of this album. I kind of want to just talk about specifically in deep dive a little.
What do we got?
Let's start with Blood on the Sand, which is maybe, it's so hard to pick. Like, this album is a lot harder for me to pick favorite songs.
Yeah. I mean, like I've listened to Hurricane and Blood on the Sand probably like 100 times in the past.
Blood on the Sand,
months.
It's not poppy in a, like, it's a glossy or sunshiny song, but the chorus is fucking addictive.
Yeah, and this is kind of doubling back to something you said in the past segment, but this is an album that if I listen to like one song, I tend to listen to the next 2 or 3. Like, it's not something that I just put on for a song. Like, it's kind of like you have to swallow it almost as like parts of a meal, where it's like an appetizer, main course, and dessert.
Let's play a little bit of the chorus of Blood in the Sand.
Yeah, cool.
Just to kind of give people the idea of the melody. I love so much about that song is like that chorus of the blah da 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 da.
The melody.
The melody is very like it's poppy in a way of like it's very earwarming and catchy. Which is a huge compliment because, like, you know from being in a band that those are so hard to write.
Yeah, it's like it's not overdoing it, but it's really catchy.
But it sticks in your head and you wake up the next morning with it. It's also like a lot of this album is very political.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I agree with that. And like that's always like in their lyrics too. I was actually shocked as to how political some of the songs are.
Yeah, and then let's go right into that for the next song I wanted to point out is Black Honey.
Yeah, which I was listening to and I'm such an idiot. But
also it's really adorable today, guys. John found out what Genius is, or Rap Genius is. It's like, oh my god, this site's amazing. They tell you what songs are about. I'm like, yeah, John, we know.
I sometimes I feel like I'm like an old person when it comes to technology, but I'm usually pretty up on shit, so I don't know, like I just don't get into like the apps, I guess.
You're very well, Genius used to be just a site. I think it's also an app now.
Yeah, now it's an app. I have it.
Well, that's probably why you didn't know about it.
Yeah, exactly,
because you're very an app guy. You're not a I'm gonna look around the interwebs.
Yeah that's exactly kind of it.
So what I want to talk about on because like the whole political thing is, it would take too much time to get into, and we don't want to go too long here,
of course.
What I want to talk about of this is that opening guitar part.
Oh, so awesome, right?
So it comes in on this acoustic part right here. And it's very like, the way it's recorded, it sounds distant.
Yeah, like when they record and they put the effects and like the production into their songs, it's fucking awesome, like every single time.
And then when it just kicks in really hard, too.
Yeah, no, it's great. Like, they've mastered now like exactly what they want to do. It's so awesome. They needed that time to refresh.
Because the thing I love so much about that too is that guitar part of it's almost this descending line of da 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 da, 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 and like you kind of walk down, but you keep that same note up high, but then that walk back up to it da, 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 is so beautiful, and it's the thing of music of like that pattern is so satisfying to listen to,
right?
Of how it loops so perfectly, but it never gets boring.
And like you're into that though too, and that's not like me saying anything with that, but like even like when we were talking about Nirvana, there was one song that we really like focused in on. And that was,
I think it's Come As You Are.
Okay, so
we were talking one day about Nirvana. We were talking about that beginning of Come As You Are. And it had that same kind of thing.
And it's really similar. And like that was something that I made in my notes that I kind of thought was interesting. And it's really funny because I was just going to bring it up because it's something you had mentioned in a previous time. And you brought it up on your own. So,
well, as a musician and as a bass player, and like when I write music a lot, it's that musical puzzle is what I'm really drawn to.
Okay.
And these are two good examples of it's very simple and it's not very long, but the way it loops, it's so satisfying. And it's such a weird thing to try to put into words of this. If you listen to Black Honey, it's something that you notice so much too, is that it kind of plays underneath the whole song.
Right.
And it's a motif in music. It's like this one. It's big in classical music where you have this one kind of repeating phrase, and you extrapolate on it, you play it different ways, and it comes back. And almost like a callback in comedy, you'll just play just that phrase again. And yes, it's very common in music too. And it's that for this song, and it's really beautiful lyrically. The song is very political, and we mentioned that.
Yeah, which I'm so dumb. I didn't pick it up until I actually.
Yeah,
like,
you didn't realize
looked
into Black Honey was oil.
Yeah, well, I mean that makes sense now, but.
No, it's one of those things of like when you told me that, I'm like, I knew that, but I never assigned those words to it.
Yeah, like I'm thinking like it could be like a stripper or something, like.
But the lyrics, not even if you take the politics out of it, they're very visual. They do a lot of like, it's very visceral, like your reaction to it. And that's different than a lot of their early stuff. Their early stuff was very intelligent. Mm-hmm. But it didn't like really put a word picture in your brain like this does.
Yeah, it's like it's no longer like they know they're smart and they're trying to be smart. It's like now just old wisdom looking back in a, you know, natural way where it's just coming to them. Like there's no extra effort.
And then the last song I wanted to kind of do a deep dive in on here is Stay With Me.
Yeah, it's a great song.
Which is standing tall among giants, because this whole album you can listen to all the way through.
Yes.
But what this album really fucking blew my mind on is this singer learned how to sing. And that's not a pejorative. He learned how to use his voice in different ways and how to like how to really hold a note and how to express himself.
Yeah, and like that's not a diss, but basically like he's got a very good, very unique voice, and it's got a lot of power, and he's now learning like how to use his power. Like basically. Yeah. It's almost like, and I hate to say it again, but it's like Professor X teaching Magneto. Mm-hmm. How to lift shit when it comes to metal.
It's like unlocking that next level. Because a lot of also like thrashy hardcore punk, like even punk, like you don't need a lot of bags of tricks vocally.
It's funny too, because that X-Men analogy, like when they're first like coming about their powers, it's all from like rage. And that's kind of like the earlier Thrice shit. And then as they get better and controlling it, it becomes more like a, you know, like just a calm, like they know what they can do, but they don't need to do it anymore. So,
well, it's what's
cool.
So beautiful about it is his voice to me, like he's learned all this depth, and it's beautiful the way he like uses that to add emotion to the song. And instead of being kind of just the lyrics tell the whole story.
Yeah.
He sings it singing to me is a lot like acting. Like you act with your whole body. And when you're singing, you need to sing with your whole voice and you need to sing with your whole body of like, adding these depths of emotion like that song.
Well, yeah, it's like even like when you see a good actor, they can do the same scene over and over again, but like they'll just like add one little nuance and it completely changes it. He can kind of, he's like figured out like what he's doing with that.
And it's kind of awesome to see a band that's been together this long and it's the same members. Like
same members. It's like a marriage that they got married in high school, mm-hmm. and they are now, they have kids.
You
their
say
kids
it, girl.
Have kids. They're mm-hmm. retired. Have a savings. They this did everything correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing too is like that guitar in the verses of Stay With Me. The only way I can describe it is like you're on a beach and it's just perfect weather and it's night and you're just looking up at the stars twinkle and really, really pretty, but it's really, really depth.
Absolutely.
That's like me getting all crazy with shit.
No, this is you showing some emotion, which makes you uncomfortable.
Yeah, I don't like it. I'm going to go back to my
you're
show.
You're so Irish Catholic.
That's what it is, man. Everything's guilt and that's it. We keep it all inside. There's so much weight. Don't let it go. So, anything else with this album? Like, what?
It's great. You want to get to our verdict on? It's kind of hard to do a verdict on these two albums of all of Thrice.
Yeah, it's tough. Well, out of the two albums, which one do you like more? And I know it's apples and oranges. I don't want to hear the whole. Like, which one?
I have
a gun to your head
more.
So you like the newer one more?
I do. It's like Artist in the Ambulance also. It's a thing of where a lot of that wasn't my thing to begin with.
Well, I think once puberty stops, Artist in the Ambulance is a lot. You know what I mean? Like it's got a lot of hormones.
It's a lot of very like pure emotion.
Yeah, a lot of testosterone.
Where To Be Everywhere is an album where I would listen to it end to end and I would listen to it completely, which is weird.
That's cool.
Because like I very much kind of switched, you know, to more of the Spotify, the iTunes culture of like, oh, I just pick the singles.
So you're gonna say out of the two albums we talked about today, the newer one is absolutely the one that you like. And you went into this like not knowing Thrice very well, and
no,
also
not at all.
Basically, also not liking them very much. You came around to really liking them.
No, honestly, I'm kind of excited now because the first album really right. opened my eyes to. I kind of got through a lot of things I had. I was holding against hardcore from being like kind of a angry punk kid in a hardcore scene.
Yeah, you were like me. Like I just like I hate shit, and I don't know why, but it's just how I am.
Right, like it's very yeah. reactionary, and it's also my knowledge of the genre is very shallow, so a lot of it sounded like cookie cutter repetitive to me.
Okay.
But Thrice kind of showed me that a lot of the stuff I thought was cookie cutter was because they did it first.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense.
So, but To Be Everywhere is definitely my more favorite, because also at my age now, it's much more my speed of what I listen to.
Okay, that works for me. So what would you get it out of five?
Okay, we're going to do out of five for each album separately.
Okay, so we're going to do both.
Yeah, so... So I'm going to give To Be Everywhere is To Be Nowhere. I'm going to give that 5 out of 5.
Oh, that's awesome. Yay! Okay. So you're giving it a perfect score.
It's an album that honestly...
That's mad respect.
I use Spotify mostly now.
Okay.
I do still buy albums.
Right.
I bought this one in iTunes.
That's fucking awesome. Did you hear that? He liked it so much. It's almost like a donation box. He went to iTunes and bought it. That's awesome, man.
Also, now I'll do my Artist in the Ambulance.
Yeah, what do you think for that one?
That one is a lot different because it was a lot for me to get over my prejudice. It was also a lot for me to figure out where I'm coming from on that.
Right.
Listening back through it now and also realizing so much stuff came out of that.
Sure.
I'm going to give that a 4 out of 5.
Yeah!
That's really good. I was expecting lower. That's from you at least. That's awesome, man.
And there's a couple songs on there that are now favorite songs of all times, that will always be in my rotation.
That's badass. That's really cool.
I was really glad you turned me on to them. I was kind of hoping I would hate them just so I could be like, oh my God, you love shit music.
No, I mean,
you picked a good one.
Well, thank you very much. But yeah, and I'm going to basically, I love these bands. It's my two favorite albums from them. So it's 5 out of 5 for both of them for me. But if I had to pick an album, I would. There's memories attached to Artists with the Ambulance because it did come out back, mm-hmm. during the younger times. But the new one for me is it's amazing. I was so happy with it. It's such a good fucking album.
Now I'm going to throw a new metric in the show on you here. Now, these are also going to go on a list that I'm going to call the mandatory listen. If you don't like hardcore or something, these albums are albums you have to have heard.
So this is for anyone that hasn't heard us do this before. This is basically a Hall of Fame kind of, I guess,
they're
something.
Benchmarks. These are albums that you need to have heard. Okay. Even if you don't like the music, just because it's out of respect for the genre and also.
Yeah, I'm down. That's cool.
Where it comes. These are albums I think in your life you should at least listen through
once. You're putting both on that.
I'm putting both. And for very different reasons.
That's fucking awesome, man.
The political and the lyrical intelligence of To Be Everywhere is so far above so much music, and it's also so coherent with a message, a good through line, good story.
That's awesome.
And it's also just great music, and it's also, it's stuff you can listen to you don't get burnt out on because it's not a shot of adrenaline to the heart.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean with that.
And Artist in the Ambulance is such a pivotal album that changed so much sound and inspired so many bands that I think it's kind of like the Beatles of hardcore. You kind of need to go back to hear it.
That's awesome. I mean, that's pretty pretty good praise coming from you.
So let's go out on I want to go out on a song that we didn't end up talking about much on Artists in the Ambulance just because there was so much to cover there. So what are some tracks if someone doesn't have time now to listen to their homework of these albums is mandatory. Let's kind of go back and forth with some tracks. Let's start with Artists in the Ambulance. What are some songs that you really want people to listen to off this?
Yeah, I'm going to throw out some of the bigger ones, but I'm going to throw out All That's Left. So I'm going to take over that one so you don't have
all
to mess
that
up
I
the
have
name.
Left now.
Yeah, All That's Left, and then Artists in the Ambulance and Stare at the Sun are great ones. Paper Tigers is my favorite.
Paper Tigers is a little too heavy for my taste, but yeah. I respect it.
It's my favorite.
I agree with all of those except Paper Tigers. Out of Paper Tigers, I would actually swap that out for Don't Tell and We Won't Ask. That was one that I really loved.
That's fair.
And now for To Be Everywhere is To Be Nowhere. What are you going to throw out there for some highlights?
I'm going to group in Hurricane and Blood on the Sand. Those are two. I constantly come to those two. I love them. That's the number one and number two song on the album.
I'm going to agree with those. I'm also going to add in, I think everyone needs to hear Black Honey.
Of course, that's a good one.
Stay With Me is just a fucking great power hit.
That follows Black Honey, so that's a good combo mix.
And then third, I want to throw in, I realized I fucked this up earlier when I was saying the verses, he had a very bluesy, sad blues man sound to his voice. I was referring to the wrong song. Wake Up off of that album has like, that's the one where he sounds like a weary blues man, and the verses like it's very somber. That's the that's the song that I think will really take you a turn on what how you see Thrice.
Yeah, but I could also maybe not like now that you're comparing it to that, I could also see where you were coming from though with the Black Honey.
Yeah. So those are the like kind of the highlight songs.
And then what about Salt and Shadow? You mentioned that before.
Oh, that one's very atmospheric. That one isn't like
maybe,
a must listen.
Yeah, maybe like don't jump into the pool with that one.
It's almost that one's almost like
it's a great closer.
It's a good album track. Like if you listen to the whole album and you stopped before that song, it would feel wrong. But also to listen to that song on its own, it feels out of place and out of context.
So let's break yourself in and then hit that one is basically.
Exactly.
I can work with that. That works. So that being said, I think we're going to wrap it up on Thrice. This was an awesome one. I was super stoked to hear that Aaron went in not knowing, not liking, liking, and then giving them great reviews and then also making them a pivotal band. So like that's amazing. So everyone else should check them out if you haven't heard them. And
absolutely.
Then so if you had to recommend anything to our listeners right now, what would you recommend? Like what are you listening to? Like give them like a recommendation.
Oh, sure. Over like the past year, so I moved to New York about 2 years ago now. We're coming up on the second year. This last year, for a lot of people, 2016 sucked dick. 2016 was awful for me.
Yeah, it wasn't a good year for
I had a lot of trouble finding jobs, a lot of time like keeping my money life together so I could survive.
Yeah, I mean, New York is it's not easy to live here.
No. So yeah. There's this folk punk musician from the UK, and he really helped me get through that. And I don't usually have that type of like feeling with music. It's not like always kind of like a been there for me thing. It's more like this is fun. So his album is called Positive Songs for Negative People by Frank Turner.
Oh, that's a good album name.
It's a great, and it's accurate. It's a song that's very optimistic for people who aren't optimistic.
Okay.
I really want you to listen to that one, John.
nothing's going to help me.
Yeah,
that's
I'm not
all
hinting at
say.
Anything there, but no, but you really should listen to it. It's fucking phenomenal. It's a lot of acoustic. There's some electric songs.
It sounds like a self-help album, but I know it's not, but.
It's a go fucking help yourself album.
Okay.
So yeah, Positive Songs for Negative People by Frank Turner. Listen to that. It's truly, I will openly admit right now, there's a point where I was having a really, really bad time, like a bad couple weeks in a row.
Right.
And I was walking around Brooklyn with headphones on, like tearing up, crying at certain songs like that because I had just discovered it. And like, but in like a cathartic way where I felt better.
Okay.
And of course, like you don't really live in New York until you've cried in public.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's something everybody does. And yeah.
It's like it's like getting your New Yorker card.
Yeah, and like I wanted to, and I'm going to get to it quick, is the name of the Thrice album, To Be Everywhere Is To Be Nowhere. To me, that's Times Square, because like that's where I go when I want to get away from everybody. And it sounds crazy because like you think of New York City, Times Square, everybody's there. But like literally, if you just go to Times Square and sit down, like nobody gives a shit that you're there. So like to me, like that's kind of where I took the name from that.
No, it's like a needle hiding in a stack of needles.
Exactly. So if I had I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to recommend a band and an album right now. I've been listening a lot to Transit, Listen and Forgive. It's a really good, they're from Boston. It's just like a pop punk. They're actually kind of more like in that hardcore, pop hardcore that kind of was mm-hmm. going on there. And it came out in like 2011. Back when it came out, I listened to it a lot. And it was actually an album that I listened to when I first moved to the city. And it was tied to a lot that was going on in my life. And then this year I've been listening to it again and it's fantastic.
I'm not familiar with them either. I think we kind of gave ourselves some homework.
Yeah, I think you'll listen to this and like it too. It's a good one.
Okay, I think you like Frank Turner. It's a little more like folk to it than you're used to, but I think you'll really respect it.
Badass. I'm down to do it.
All right. So we got through two albums of Thrice.
And one more podcast in the book. We're doing it, baby.
Yeah, next week, episode 4. So we're going to go out on a song here. Let's go out on Don't Ask and We Won't Tell off of Artist in the Ambulance.
Sounds good, man.
All right. See everybody next week.
See ya. Hey everyone, we just wanted to give credit to the songs that were used in this episode of the Pod Punk Show. We have from Thrice, Deadbolt, that's off the album Illusion of Safety from 2002. We also have from Thrice, All That's Left, Stare at the Sun, Artist in the Ambulance,
Don't Ask and We Won't Tell. These are all off their album, The Artist in the Ambulance, from 2003. Also by Thrice, Black Honey, Blood on the Sand, and Hurricane, off their full length, To Be Everywhere is to Be Nowhere, from 2016. Other songs played on this episode, Blink-182, M&amp, off their Cheshire Cat, 1995. Senseless Beauty, the song's called Reverse the Curse, it's off Surviving, 2010. And then, of course, Nirvana, Come As You Are, off of Nevermind, from 1991. Please go out and support all these artists anywhere that music is sold. And this is the Pod Punk Show. It's produced by John Bryan and Aaron Haag, and it was edited by Aaron Haag. Thanks for listening.
Bonus means extra. I know that from game shows.
And that's the other thing too, is like, I think like I would be a good serial killer, because like they say like it's very difficult to catch them, and like they usually mess up, like that's how they get caught. And I'm even like the other day, like when I was telling you or you were trying to cover up because like you were setting up the mic stands and you were like, oh shit, this is yours. And then you made a comment about how you're like, well, you should have put it on the, oh. And then you saw that I did put the thing on the outside.
Yeah,
so you
should have
already known. So like, I just feel like if that's really what it is when it comes to a serial killer getting caught, it's just basically like them like fucking up their routine. I feel bad for that city because it's not going to be good.
This is the dumbest humble brag I've ever heard. I am organized enough that if I chose to become a serial killer, I would never be caught.
I'm not a serial killer, but I'm just saying it would be a fucking awesome one.
I'm just saying I'm good with iCal and spreadsheets.
I would be a really awesome one.